that was the most solemn I think I've heard you in years. Isn't that true? It was like COVID all over again with 9 of us here. It's like, it's Palm Sunday. It's a glorious day. And you all think I'm an idiot. And you're right. All right. So that is correct. So, well, welcome to First Brethren Church. If you're here, if you're following us online, we thank you for joining us. If you'll take your bulletin, you can get on firstbrethren.org. Yes, I am Pastor Fred. I am the idiot up here. And so I have no problem with that. We call Scott knucklehead, and that's okay. I'm an idiot. We work out well. Yeah. And Bill's not here, so we won't tell you his nickname. So, Paula, don't tell him I said all that, okay? But a few things here in your bulletin. First thing, you have the Global Partners insert. This is Global Partners Month, so hopefully if you're more than welcome to contribute through the Faith Promise to Global Partners. And then the other insert is about this week, and we hope that you would use this to invite people to join us. You'll notice, obviously, today is Palm Sunday, and this is our full communion Sunday. You're welcome to participate. I'll describe all of that parts as we go through them. Good Friday, this Friday from 6:30 to 7:30, the sanctuary will be open. We'll have the other decorations in here, the crosses and so on, and time just to come and meditate. There'll be some soft music playing, and there's nothing else going on. It's just a time to come in and meditate. And then sunrise service is 8 o'clock. Pray for Cheryl this morning. She's not able to be with us. She's sick, and so she is speaking for us on sunrise service. And just so you know, the services are different, so don't think if you come to the first one, it's identical to the second one. That's not true. The first service is sunrise service. It's very much smaller. It does incorporate a different speaker, so Cheryl Kisner speaking. We'll have a time of communion, and then we go to our breakfast, continental breakfast in the Great Hall, and then we'll come back 9:30 for our total celebration of resurrection, and then second hour after that. So take this insert and use that to invite somebody else to join us next Sunday or next Friday. And in your bulletin are a couple of other things I want to highlight. First of all, if you take the response tab, fill that out, put that in the offering chest. We'd appreciate that very much. And then anyone interested in church membership, we are still working on a class for that. Community care opportunity, you can read that and all of those things that are there. It is a busy week, but at the same time, we don't want it to be so busy we miss the focus of what Holy Week is all about. And that's what I'm going to be presenting part of that this morning in our service. One of the things that I'm going to focus on this morning, there we go, is a subject of attire. And in Isaiah 61, we see a prophecy that is fulfilled in Revelation. And in Isaiah 61, we find these words, "I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels." So we have a picture of a wedding going on. But the fulfillment is in Revelation 19. "Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready." Key word there, she's ready. "And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints." As we think of attire this morning, we think of our awesome God. And we're going to start with a hymn by Charles Wesley, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain." I'm going to ask if you would join us by standing, or if you need to be seated, that's fine too. You don't have to stand. But if you'd like to join us in standing, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain an Interest in the Savior's Blood." Died he for me,
his Father's throne above. So free, so infinite his grace, emptied himself of all but love, and bled for Adam's helpless race. 'Tis mercy all immense and free, for oh my God, it found out me. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? Long my imprisoned spirit lay, fast bound in sin and nature's night. Thine eye diffused a quickening ray. I woke, the dungeon flamed with light. My chains fell off, my heart was free, and hope went forth and followed thee. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me?
All right, what's the passage that this verse comes from? No condemnation now I dread. I'll give you hints as Romans chapter 8. No condemnation. What does that mean? What's that? You can't use the same word in the definition. You're not a teacher, I know, but that drives teachers crazy. No condemnation. No punishment. There's a teacher, all right? No punishment. No condemnation. Sing it as you don't have it, all right?
No condemnation now I dread, Jesus and all in him is mine. Alive in him, my living head, and clothed in righteousness.
Said. Amen. Jen will lead us in prayer.
Dear Father, we come to you this morning and we're just grateful to be in your house, grateful to be with your people. We're grateful to be celebrating Palm Sunday and just this time of year that brings us to a point of reverence, of just recognizing the fact that you did come to earth, that you ministered, but then you came here to die for our sin, that we might have no more condemnation, that we would be free of the punishment and the weight and the wrath of sin. And Father, we just think of this time that we have this morning. I pray that we would just all come with open hearts and open minds, that we would be open to whatever you're going to present to us, that we would just apply that in our lives, that we would go out and be the light in the world that you have sent us to be. We pray this all in your name. Amen.
To stand or be seated, but we're going to start with the song, How Great is Our God. Think about how great he's been to you. As we just sang, no condemnation now I dread. What an awesome God we have in our lives.
Mm-hmm.
the splendor of the King. Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. Is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and I will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end. Beginning and the end, the Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Amen. Remain standing for the reading of God's word. We're in. You can change one vowel on the name there. Jen is going to read this morning.
Very, very close, but I can't ever be as great as the Drake Jagger. Jesus washes his disciples' feet. It was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus answered, "A person who has had a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is clean, and you are clean, though not every one of you." For he knew who was going to betray him, and that was why he had said not everyone was clean. When he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. "Do you understand what I have done for you?" he asked them. "You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am.
Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. I tell you the truth, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. I am not referring to all of you. I know those I have chosen. But this is to fulfill the scripture. He who shares my bread has lifted up his heel against me. I am telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am he. I tell you the truth. Whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me. Yes.
We have been teaching you this new song, Crown Him Majesty, and I'm going to ask you this morning to really focus on these words. Hopefully you know you've been set up, but next week you'll sing this one more time, all right? And as we sing this, it's not a matter of learning a new song. You know the words if you've been in church for a long time with the hymn. But focusing on that new chorus, Majesty, Lord of all, let every throne before him fall. Think about falling before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne, our God.
said.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. As I want to always make sure, I thank you for your support for this local ministry and the denomination and God's church in general. As you pray, as you give, as you serve, many people serve in different ways. Yesterday we had a work day, there are people here that serve that way. Other people are serving, they can't get out and do anything, but they can pray. And so dare we not forget that there's work of the ministry going on all around us all the time. And we always want to thank our God for that. And let's sing together the doxology this morning. Praise Him this morning. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Father, we thank you for all that you do for us, for life and breath, for salvation, for sanctification, for hope and peace, and every moment of every day, you are there for us. May we not cease to thank you and praise your holy name. We thank you for the opportunity of gathering today, and as we focus upon your word and what you've taught us to do, may you be honored, glorified, and exalted. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Our time of prayer this morning, you can see the prayer requests are there in your bulletin, and there's many there. Definitely remember the Benko family as the funeral for Sherry is this Tuesday at Geisinger Chapel there on Michigan. And if you remember that family in particular, and the Riley family, we don't have any services for her yet, but we want to remember the Benko family. Are there any that I've missed? There's always those.
There's a couple listed in there from Dennis. Cousin's daughter, Brianna, is having that pretty intense surgery on Thursday.
6:30 in the morning.
Okay. So they're in your prayer request. Brianna, a 27-year-old cousin of Dennis's, having brain surgery. And I want to remember Brianna. Also, John Moracle, that's Dennis's cousin, and has surgery on Tuesday to remove a stent. So there's a lot there. So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Almighty God, we come to you. We praise you. We thank you. We also seek your face and the wisdom that we don't have, but you do. And you know our hearts and our emotions, that we want everybody healed and we don't want distress and struggles, but yet through those we learn. And so, Father, as we present all of these people to you, John and Brianna and others that are going through tests and surgeries, and Father, we ask your peace upon all of these people, that they may know your presence, and first of all, that they would know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. And they will also know you in a deeper faith. But Father, if it be your will to touch them and heal them right at this moment or later on or through doctors, or maybe there's a time that you have infinitely wise know when it needs to be done. And so, Father, we submit ourselves to you as we lift up prayer requests to you. There's many here. There's many on our hearts this morning. But Father, for those with physical needs, we've lifted them. We pray for those with mental, emotional needs, financial needs, various needs in our lives. But Father, may we come to you and seek your face in each situation. But Father, we pray for those that need to know Jesus Christ. We pray for our global partners around the world, international workers. Father, I think of one in particular that is very much in a dangerous situation, and I pray that you protect them. Father, I pray for those that are in prison for their faith and families that have lost loved ones because they've been murdered for you. They're your martyrs. Father, we pray for peace and comfort upon those families. May they stand strong in their faith. But Father, as we open your word today, may we allow your Holy Spirit to guide us and teach us, that we'd be drawn closer to you. And not only closer, but that we'd have a more passion to know you. We thank you for this week as we celebrate, as well as meditate upon all that you have done for us, Jesus. May your Holy Spirit have the freedom to work in us now, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our memory verse, let's recite it. Reference, then the verse, and then the reference again. John 16:24. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. John 16:24. Hopefully you've taken the time to memorize. Number four, absolutely. I know that was my kids' favorite number. All their jerseys have number four on the back. So, all right. Well, if you take your Bible, please, there's going to be a bunch of passages we're going to be looking at this morning. And I apologize. I'm trying to look trendy, all right? I've got my coffee cup up here with it. For some reason, nothing extra, just the coffee. And most of you know this is not real coffee. This is sludge, all right? My son makes me this wonderful sludge for me. But something in my throat this morning is just tickling, so here, just to make sure I'm okay to speak. We have been talking about what does the Bible really say, and as we come today, it's Holy Week. And I didn't grow up really with Holy Week mentality. We had Palm Sunday, we had Good Friday, and Easter, And over the years, I don't even like to use the word Easter because I looked up its origin and so on. I use Resurrection Sunday. But what does the Bible tell us what happened to Jesus during that week? And here's what happened. They had an Easter egg hunt. They dyed eggs. They had chocolate eggs with wonderful Reese's peanut butter in the middle. What? Peeps. Oh, I forgot. Oh, Leanna, I am so sorry. I forgot to put Peeps up there. That's her favorite candy. Oh, I didn't put Peeps up there. Sorry. Matter of fact, it was funny because when I found the paws up there, I grew up, my mom would buy. That's one thing we would buy, that paws thing, and take those little things and put them in the vinegar with, you know, take your eggs and dip them in there. Everybody's having, I mean, that was fun, you know? Of course, then you got it all over you. And then you tried to take that wax crayon and really draw on the. That never worked, but we tried. You know, and that was Easter 2,000 years ago. You all know better than that. Come on, not. Sorry, there were no Peeps 2,000 years ago either. But when you think about Easter, it's probably all the traditions that we grew up with. But this morning, I want us to remember Sunday's best. Do you remember that for Easter? If my sister's watching, I even put a little simplicity pattern up there. Some of you remember the pattern, Simplicity Butterworth, and my mom had all that because she was a seamstress, and she would make a new dress for my sisters every Easter, and she also made me suits. She was that good of a seamstress. But when you think about Sunday best, I remember that Sunday. That was the one you really dressed up well. Matter of fact, when I came here, and Paula Freed's not with us, but she would always wear a hat and gloves. You remember Paula coming in with hat and gloves? It was like, just classy, you know? I just always appreciated that with Paula. But you know what really happened? What was Jesus' attire? Do you think he got all dressed up to die? Yep, it's that time. Let's put on the gold chains. Let's put on the best of robes. I found 12 things that Jesus wore during Holy Week. And we're going to leave these centers up here during Good Friday also. So if you're here and you come back on Friday, you'll have time to meditate upon the clothing that's going to be up here this morning. And I forgot to tell you, Joshua, this morning I'm going to pan over to both sides, so you're going to need to follow me a little bit on this. But in your bulletin, some notes if you want to follow along. So the 12 things that I found here, I also want to thank Andrew this morning. Andrew drew that picture for us. It's just beautiful. And so just thank you for doing that. But we're going to look at 12 different pieces of articles that Jesus wore. And we're going to start with his feet. And he wore sandals. And that's true. That's absolute. Because in Matthew chapter 3, it talks about Jesus wearing sandals. Now, some of this is just common sense, right? He had to wear some clothes, and what was their tradition at that time? And so literally there were the sandals, and John said, I'm not even worthy to take his sandals off. And this was way early on in Matthew. But we also find Jesus wore a tunic. Now, the tunic we're going to start with is what we're going to call the undergarment. We might call it underwear, all right? But it's not the same mentality as we have today. So it would be a one piece, more than likely, longer than this, that would probably go almost all the way to the ankles, and it would be made out of one piece of clothing, or one piece of thread. So it wouldn't be torn or cut or anything like that. It would just, sometimes there would be an opening, all right, so they hadn't woven the opening in the middle, and would just go straight down over top. So there would be this one piece of undergarment. And many times, if you think back into later on where it talks about girding your loins, they would take and pull that up, and many times they would have a belt, or they would finagle it and tie it together so that they could run with this undergarment that did hang down to their ankle area. So when you start thinking about how would they run with something like that, never worn a skirt, never planned to, but just taking it up and then under putting it either under a belt or tying it to the side, you could then run a lot faster. And so that was called girding up your loins. But this would be the undergarment. The third garment that we find is a tallit. This is what we call prayer shawl, and you've seen mine many times around here. But this is what Jesus would wear, and this is what's referenced when the lady touches the hem of his garment. And that's the tassels at the bottom. They all have a representation. There's knots, and there's blue thread in one of them. And you can go back to Exodus, find out why that all is. There's a reason for all of that, for wearing a special covering of your head to pray. And so he had one of those. Now, you're thinking at this point, well, okay, this all makes sense. Well, the next thing would be an outer garment. Now, pulled this one out of our many different costumes here, but more than likely, Jesus didn't have a red one, all right? Typically, when you think of Jesus, Jesus always tried to identify with whom? The common people, everyday people, yeah. And everyday people more than likely would have had brown, gray, because the sheep had a grayish color. They weren't pure white, sorry to tell you. All the sheep we usually find in pictures are like these pure white sheep. They're very much a musky color, a grayish, dark gray, black. That would have been the common outer tunic that they would have wore. This would have had holes in so they could put arm like a jacket, and this would be what we'd call the outer garment. So we have an inner garment or undergarment, we have an outer garment, we have a tallit, a prayer shawl, we have his shoes or his sandals. The next thing would be a headpiece. Now, I am not good at doing this, all right, so I'm not even going to try this morning. But what it is basically is a single piece of linen, and you're able to do it. Bree has something going on this morning. We call them tunics a lot of times. And they're able to wind these around their heads and able to tie it so that it stays right on top of their head. Now, you would say, Pastor, you don't have any verses up there. This is the one thing I don't have a verse for specifically, but there's no doubt he wore one. Why can I say that? Well, everybody did, and you got to remember your location. You're in a warm location, sun beating down. If you're a shepherd, you always wore something on your head. You'd burn your head. And so you would have to have some type of headpiece, just plain and simple, for your environment. So typically we call them a tunic, but that would be something Jesus would have definitely wore. And then the one we're going to look at today and specifically would be a towel. Now, interesting enough with a towel, and I only brought this one out, it definitely would not have looked like this. But this would be a typical bath towel, as we would call it. But it would have definitely been much longer than this, because in John 13, it says Jesus wraps it around his waist and also does what with it? Wipes the people's feet with it. So it's not just a bath towel that he put around him. It would have been a much longer garment, which would have been able to tie or fold in, and then still use it to wipe the feet of the people that he's washed. And so this would have been much longer. Again, probably not white like this. Now, they were able to make white clothing, but typically things were more of a beige, brown, the color of the fabric that had been used or the wool that typically was used. So far, not much intrusiveness about this part of the clothing that he had. But now we get to, that's the first couple of days, and we're now probably to Thursday. And Passover has occurred, and that's where the towel comes in. But then we get to the part closer to his death, burial, and resurrection. And this probably we would call maybe a little bit of a harder part, because it's the items that he wears not by choice. The first one would be a blindfold. There's two possibilities. Just a single piece of fabric that you would put around the eyes, tie it behind, or it could be like a bag, like a pillowcase, you might say. It was just put over the head so the person couldn't see. This was one of the tricks of the Romans, because they would like to beat people, but not to be identified who was the one to hit them. This is specifically what happens here in Luke 22. Now the men who were holding Jesus in custody were mocking him and beating him. You'll notice the word there, beating. It's not just a, okay, I hit you once, or I hit you in the shoulder. My kids do that to me. And you know, you just tap in something. No, this is beating. And they blindfolded him, and then they asked him, saying, prophesy who is the one that hit you. In this piece of clothing, the one that Jesus never chose to wear, this is significant. He was put on his head, not for the purpose so he couldn't see, but for the purpose to mock him. To say, you say you're a prophet, you say you're a priest, you say you're a king, so go ahead, let's cover your eyes, and we're going to hit you, and we want to know, can you identify us? Now, we would all say, well, that'd be very difficult if we had to try to do that. Obviously, Jesus in his infinite deity probably could have. But in the mockery, that's the intent of this piece of clothing. Because, and they were saying many other things against him, blaspheming. We're fortunate sometimes to not have all the information. I would just start to boil if I knew probably the blasphemous words they put upon him. Not too bad of a tire over here. We've gotten to a whole difficult place over here. The next thing is the crown of thorns. They put a purple robe on him and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. Now, it's interesting. Zoe, you want to come wear this for me? Say no. Okay, good. I don't want to put this on your head. You know, and these ones are semi-authentic. There's another one we have. It's longer. I just chose not to bring it out, but it wasn't just little like thorns on a rose. These things go 3 to 4 inches long. And they put it on his head and thrust it down on his head. Again, another attire that he did not choose. He didn't say, take my ball cap off, or put a ball cap on, or a beret, or something nice. But purpose? To mock him. Plain and simple, these articles become mockery. The articles that he didn't choose to wear. The ninth one is a reed. I know some of you might say this isn't actually a piece of garment or clothing, but if I use the word attire, we'll accept it as attire. But they gave him a reed. Now, this is a piece of bamboo, but some type of reed. We know that these kind of things grow over there, not to the degree, this is probably more from like the Asian area, but some kind of reed that he would have in his hand. If I read Matthew 27, think through this. And they stripped him and put him on with a scarlet robe. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." So the article itself really isn't the issue, is it? It's what they use the article for. To say, "You claim to be a king." Well, that's not a king's scepter. It's just a reed. And they bowed down to him. Now, I hate to do the I told you so stuff, but there will be a day that every knee will bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord. In Philippians chapter 2, Paul writes that. But I can imagine as they took this, and they might have even taken this exact reed and beat him with it. Beat the crown on top of his head. Part of the attire that we often forget about Holy Week is the reed. It could do some significant damage. So now he's been blindfolded, crown of thorns, a reed in his hand, his right hand. Interesting they say right hand. Right hand is a what? Show of what? Authority and power. Yeah. It's if you in the Jewish tradition, it's lean to the left for freedom, but the right is for authority and power. They even mocked him to that degree, put it in his right hand, specific to mock him. But the next piece is the purple garment. Most of us have known this part of the story, the purple garment. Now, one of the translations uses the word scarlet or red or crimson. It's one word, and it's all the same. And it's interesting because many people have tried to argue the point, well, it's purple or it's red. You got to remember, their colors are not like ours today in that purified state. And so it's a combination of the color. It was probably a dull purple that had a reddish hue to it. And so one author chose to translate it red, and the other translated purple. But this purple garment is quite interesting because purple is not something that was an everyday color. It was a sign of royalty. It was respected. It was expensive. Go to Acts and talk about Lydia and purple. And so this garment is very much a mocking thing also. They dressed him in a purple robe, twisted together the crown of thorns, and set it on his head. That's the simple version. But when you think about it, here, put this on. When you start putting these things together, the antithesis of all of this is the total opposite of who Christ was, isn't it? He never claimed to be royal. He never claimed to wear a crown. Never claimed to have a scepter. And never claimed to know everything. And to prophesy what everybody wanted. But yet, that's their interpretation. One of the things about the current purple garment I love is if you go to the Old Testament and you see the temple veil and a description of it being blue on one side and red on the other. What happens in that? Well, and the veil was considered to be about 3 inches thick. If you have red on one side and blue on the other, what do you think's in the middle? Purple. Whether that's prophetic or not, it's an interesting thought in looking at the Old Testament and the reason for the veil and how it was made. Also as a single thread, which is likewise to the undergarment that he wore. So when we get to the 11th thing, which is a very general thing, it talks about many garments, and so I just threw one other garment up here. It's possible that Jesus had another tunic. Maybe somebody gave it to him, but it talks about that there's garments, so we don't know the plurality there, but I don't think that's really something we have to concern ourselves with. We know he had an undergarment. We know he had an outer garment. We know he had a prayer shawl. And that was of his own accord. He also took the towel of his own accord to show himself as a servant to his people. But when we get to this side, everything has been put upon him of these garments. And so is the last one. And this one probably intrigues me the most, the burial clause. And he entered the tomb. This isn't Jesus. This is Peter probably. And he entered the tomb, and he looked at the linen wrappings lying there, and the face cloth which had been on his head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but folded up in a place by itself. These two garments, and I put them together as one, show an interesting thing. The face wrapping, many times it's called a napkin. It's not a napkin per se. It's a smaller piece. It was placed right on the head of the deceased. You got to remember, there's no mausoleums or whatever, so the tomb was a hewn out rock. Not big stone, but a stone because they would probably crawl in to get inside, but big enough it's heavy. It couldn't just be manually moved by one person. To get in there, to lie the body in there, to place a napkin cloth over top of the face, and then to wrap the body almost like a mummy. So it would have been torn into pieces. Which is interesting because this word is identical to the word that Mary and Joseph put Jesus in, swaddling clothes. Swaddling clothes are death clothes, which is interesting. He was born and placed in swaddling clothes. He died in swaddling clothes, death clothes. And sometimes people would say, well, he was born to die, and that's true. The total intent of the Christ was to come and die in our place. And the attire that he wore was for you and me. I think all of us could wear this stuff, right? We could all wear the outer garment, blah, blah, blah. Get to this side. Really, there's only one piece here I want to wear. It's the purple garment. But when you think about what Jesus did in the attire that he wore, it shows us an incredible picture. As my mom was a seamstress and we had material all over the house, and she would make these things, and it was intricate. She did a phenomenal job. I never was a seamstress. Both my sisters can. But as I think of the garments, it's not how they were made is the issue. It's what they represent. And the representation of these garments shows us the common God-man. Not royalty, not flamboyance, not anything, but a servant. But the God-man over here, man, takes my sin, my punishment. He's mocked for my behalf, on my behalf. He shouldn't have to take any of that. Not one even breath of that should he have had to take in. And definitely not die. The wonder to me of all the attire is the little face cloth. Because you know it specifically said it was folded up, or actually the word there is rolled up. Now you think about this. Jesus rises from the dead, stands up, swaddling clothes fall off. What does he have to do with the face napkin? He has to pick it up and fold it and place it in the tomb. The symbolism of the face cloth is very important to me. The swaddling clothes, he did his job, he's done. It's laying there. But rolling up the face napkin says I'm coming back. The tradition of taking the time to roll it up would be to say I'm coming back. Folding it up. The attire, actually, what they set him up to do was exactly what needed to happen, wasn't it? And it needed to happen for you, and it needed to happen for me. But so is that face cloth. Because if Jesus doesn't come back, we're hopeless, right? He could rise from the dead, but then say, I'm not coming back for you. Oh, I'll do all that work and we don't get to go be with you? But that little face cloth shows us that he cares for us and he's coming back for us. So I ask you this morning, what's your attire? And I'm not asking, this morning I wore a tie and I don't have to. I just felt it was what I wanted to do. And we've never told you, you have to have a certain attire to come in here. Because honestly, I don't care what you wear. The attire that I care about is this one, or what you might say, this one. Because Jesus took our crown of thorns and turned it into a crown of life. And not only a crown of life that, yes, Jesus, you've done it for me. You've done this so I can have hope. But he's also done it for, as Paul says these words, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. If there's one piece of clothing I want you to wear, it's Jesus. Put on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Put him on. Let him cover you. Let him adorn you. We don't need jewelry and all the stuff. What we need is a salvation and sanctification of a Savior. And he already has done it. He doesn't need to do it again, but he's waiting for us to put him on and live out his life in us. Can you do that? What does the Bible really say? Holy Week is awful, or is awesome and awful, yet wonderful, yet compassionate, yet glorious. All of those things put together. When you look at the attire of Jesus, don't just say, oh, that's what he wore and that's what he had to do. But there's one other piece we're going to talk about next week. I just baited you. There's one other piece of attire we're going to look at, and it's based around this. The insignificant reed. Let's pray. Father, we come to you. And we thank you for your love that sent your Son to die for us. And Jesus, that you not only chose to come, but willingly came and wore these clothes. And even the ones that you didn't choose to wear, but were thrust upon you. I pray that this morning, if there's one that has never trusted in Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior, that they would see their need for him through what he's done. And for you, oh God, we thank you for making the provision of eternal life through your Son. But we also know there's something more. So we even anticipate what we'll look at next week. For you, O Jesus, have not stopped with just your salvation and sanctification. But there's even another step of what you wear. But Father, I pray today as we look at a love feast and a foot washing and a Eucharist that we would look at you, O God, in more than just a clothing, but who you are and what you've done for us. We thank you for wearing our clothes and taking our penalty and giving us hope and peace and salvation. And we pray this in Jesus' name. As we have said earlier, and I hope that those that are joining us via streaming this morning, that we are taking full communion this morning. And so as we take a full communion, we will take of the bread and cup in here. And then what we'll do next is we'll have a time of foot washing if you choose to participate in that. And that will be done back in the classrooms in the back. Yet we'll stay in here and we'll have some hymn favorites and testimonies and so on during that time. And then when the foot washing is complete, we'll all go back to the Great Hall and have lunch together. And so hopefully you can stay and participate in each part of that today with us. But the focus always has to be when we participate in the full communion. It's about Jesus and what he's done and what the Father's love has shown us. One of my favorite songs, Isaac Watts wrote, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross." And let's, as we prepare for taking of the bread and cup this morning, let's focus upon the cross. Now, it's okay to focus on the cross. We know there's a resurrection, okay? But we also need to focus on what he did. So let's start our portion of the Eucharist this morning with "When I Survey."
Oh,
threefold communion. It is understanding of what Christ did, celebrating by taking of the elements. That's the salvation. The foot washing shows us service. He served his disciples. And he serves us today as our Savior, our Sanctifier, our Healer, and Coming King, and all that he does. And the agape meal shows us the time of fellowship, of sanctification with one another. So the completeness of full communion is absolutely wonderful. And I pray that you can stay, even if you don't participate in the foot washing or other things, I pray that you would stay and enjoy the fullness of what Christ or God is giving us as an example with this. But before we take of bread and cup, Paul admonishes that we look inside ourselves. Where are we spiritually before we partake? It's not that, I got to make sure every sin and blah, blah, blah. You know, it's not the legalism, but it's the understanding to look inside. Am I right with God? Am I right with Jesus right now? And able to take this and understanding of the sacredness and the mystery of the body and blood of Christ. Let's take a few moments of self-examining. Father, Son, and Spirit, as we take of these two elements now, we take them in somberness of understanding the cost. We take them in celebration of understanding the purpose. And we thank you, Jesus, for paying the penalty of our sin. And we thank you that you're alive today. And we thank you that you are there for us today. And we take these in remembrance of what you have done and looking forward to what you are still going to do. We thank you for being our Savior. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We are going to take this morning, we're going to take it a little different. Sometimes we serve and you take wherever you want. But this morning we're going to ask is, as you come and partake, and the one thing I really love about how Jesus did this, we assume that they passed a tray around the table. Well, there wasn't a tray. It was just some bread and a cup. But the understanding of coming to his table, and for years, I grew up, it was just trays passed through the aisles. But I love the idea of coming up, because it shows that I want to do this. I want to partake. Now, at the same time, we know some of you can't. And so Jack and Kathy are going to be on each side. And so if you want them to serve you a bread and cup, please just raise your hand and they will come and serve you. I'll be up here. We're going to come down the center aisle. So whenever you'd like to come in and receive your bread and cup, but we're going to ask that you would hold it until you get back to your seat. And then when everybody is served, then I'll take a bread and cup, and we're going to partake together this morning. So if you would join me in that this morning. Jana's going to play some songs, but please hold the elements, and we'll take together this morning. Thank you. And Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. And as often as you eat it, remember me." Let us remember the body of Christ. In the same way, he took the cup. He said, "This is the cup, the renewed covenant. And as often as you drink it, remember me." Let us remember Jesus' blood. And he said, "It was finished." You can pass those around. Do you all know that song that Jana played at the end, "Behold the Lamb"? Some say yes. Yeah, I don't think I've heard that in 20-some years. It's been a long time. But there is a song that I love. "Wonderful, Merciful Savior." It really culminates all that Christ did for us there on the cross. Let's sing this to him this morning, because he is the wonderful, merciful Savior.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
Of foot washing, and I've explained this how many times, but it's so difficult sometimes because we can have a phobia or misunderstand what foot washing is. And Jane and I were talking one of these days this week, and I usually try to remember everybody's feet that I've washed, and I pray for them periodically. And so I remember, I think Jack was the first one when I was here. I washed his feet that first time, and well, actually Pastor Larry the first time, but Jack in a regular communion. But last time, I didn't wash anybody's feet. I washed John Bush's hands. We washed hands the last time. And, you know, we kind of, I hope, broke down a little bit of a barrier. That idea it has to be feet. The understanding of foot washing is servanthood, to serve one another. And it's not just the person, like, I'm going to serve Jack. No, Jack is a representation of this body of Christ. So I'm serving the us. And so as we participate in this today, if you choose not to wash somebody's feet, that's okay. Maybe say, can I wash your hands? Or maybe you don't want to do either, but maybe you can sit there and say, God, I want to serve the body of Christ. So I'm not giving you an out, but I'm saying, if you don't want to participate in that way, please do not leave this element out of full communion. It is so vital to understand what Jesus was trying to teach his disciples, because this was the last time that he was with them there in the upper room. And the example is obviously much more important than what he just said. He did it. Peter had the problem, didn't he? Lord, you aren't washing my feet. You got to wash all of me. I mean, almost when you say that's arrogant, Peter, come on. But it's like, but you know, when Peter said that, it gave us a lesson too, didn't it? Because Jesus responded, no, Peter, settle down. You need to understand what this is about. And so I want to make sure this morning as we participate in feet washing that it's not the actual act, but it's the attitude. May we serve the us together. And that's not just this local church, but all people of the body of Christ. So what we will be doing is we will spend some time. Deacons and deaconesses, some will come in and ask if you want to participate. You can go back to one of the rooms and participate. You can stay here with us, and we're going to sing some songs, have some testimonies. And have we stopped the streaming, or we're still on? We're going to at the end of this point, so yes. But thank you for everybody that's joined us. So yes, you can stop it.